on your agenda. I think this just came up like last week or so.
Yes.
And so we're so happy when you're in our region to be able to come here today and get in front of you. I'm first going to introduce everyone. We have Doyle Jelsing. He is here representing the Kennebec, the newly formed Kennebec EDA. He is also a bank at Neighborhood Bank. He's also the president at Neighborhood Bank. And really, I think it was his hard work on broadband issues that made him the chair of the EDA, as well as even establishing the EDA. This is a very, very new program, but broadband definitely works into economic development and therefore their team. And then, as you mentioned, Robert Musgrove, who was the former president of the Pine Tech Community College. This is also another new EDA that Robin is now in his retirement, his new job, representing Pine County. And so we are all part of a group called, well, I can introduce myself. I'm Nancy Hoffman with Chisago County HRA EDA. And I've been working with broadband issues in counties for more than 10 years, I'm sure. Just never seen it as critical as it is right now, because now it's not just the city's issues, it's the whole county, it's the townships. So we're just really trying to move forward with this. GPS 4593 was actually the brainchild of Robert Musgrove in his college days, technical college days as president. And he had this vision of a technology corridor from Duluth to Minneapolis, right through the heart of our region, attracting technology companies to the area based on a fiber backbone that was going through the county. It since has morphed into more of an economic development group where we work together. We know we can get more done together. We are interested in technology and technology businesses, but really it's attraction and retention of businesses, workforce issues, that type of thing. We've always talked about broadband at our meetings, but most recently we decided we should get together and do something together. We're all doing something, but why don't we pull it together and see if we can't get something done? So a few months ago, we made a request to Blandon Foundation and received some technical assistance to help us work together to determine what we're doing together and how do we get this going. So I want to just real briefly introduce a few other people that are on our newly formed task force of the GPS group. Becky Laurie, as you know, former senator and also a high technology business owner in the heart of Pine County with big broadband needs. Jordan Zeller is with the Regional Development Commission, East Central, so he covers our whole territory and has just been a great resource for us. And then we have Greg Anderson, who is Isanti County Commissioner. And Isanti County has recently completed a feasibility study, or maybe you're still in the middle of it, but they're doing one for their county to find out what they can do for broadband. So at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Doyle.
Thank you for hosting us and listening to us. A couple of just quick side notes. I think we saved the best for last. When you have me talking about broadband, it's like putting a thing of candy in front of a two-year-old. The only way that it's going to get controlled is if some other forces sitting next to me to keep me in line. So, as we go about, I think we're on to regional commonalities. And what we're doing here is we're talking about our region, 7E. The GPS 45 represents five counties, and we get labeled with that region number, I think from D, I think is where it comes from, I'm not sure. So we wanted to talk about why is it important to us as a region and tie that back. So as we go forward, there's more need in 7E. And I want to pick out one point in Marine's presentation, rural equity. She talked about that in rural equity. And I think that's the whole sum of our presentation today as we see that. 7E has more need for broadband investment, then we believe that, and we don't want to create the controversy between urban and metro, but it's a reality. It really is, and for these reasons. We have higher rates of poverty in these counties. And there are the numbers compared to, I think, a state number, above or below. I think it's in the eighths and ninths.
Let's see, 10.2 is what you have up there.
Okay.
Is that one?
Oh, sorry, 10.2, okay? But in Pine, Mille Lacs, and Kennebec, the northern ones, we have a higher rate of, what does that mean? Workforce education is much more important priority for us. And with the distribution of the education facilities, therefore the education connection through broadband becomes that much more important. And even more so when it is, when you need to apply that education in off hours. I mean, they can't go to the institutions, they have to connect to that classroom or to that lab setting, and then they need that connection. And you don't have that availability once you get to outstate Minnesota or outside of even the cities within our county. So that's the important thing about the workforce education, why it's, we have the largest number of outbound commuters. Okay, 59% of our workforce commutes outside our region, okay? Which means that we should be the hotbed of work from home, right? But what's the reality? Are we? No. What's the biggest obstacle? We can't connect, okay? Relatively low tax base. The solutions that we are trying to find and the models that we're trying to find the infrastructure many, many times comes back to, and border to border is the prime example, is it enough, you know, to make that economic model to get a private party to come in? It gets, that model gets that much harder to achieve once you go to rural, okay? And so then now all of a sudden you're coming back to saying, okay, what resources can we put to it? Our county budgets with the lower tax base do not have the money to say we can simply grant it. It's just not, that resource is just not available to the rural county. So we'll have to look at either increased match programs or other sources, and we're going to head towards that towards the conclusion. So, the higher percentage, I think, if I'm on the right, okay, the higher percentage of residents living outside cable-served cities. I'm going to use Kennebec County. I'm familiar with that. We have cable provided in the city of Mora, and one little thing in Quamba, and one thing in Ogilvy. But as you look at our population, 70-some percent of our population is not within that range of the county population. So the percentage that's displaced is much greater as a percentage in the county, okay? Which means that when you get to the color maps, our county is sunburned, it's red, okay? The spillover development opportunities. Our region is within 75% of the state of Minnesota's population, within an hour. Okay. And again, you would think that that should make us the hotbed of, if you want quality of life that's rural, but yet you need the connection and the conveniences of the urban life, why isn't everybody moving to our region? I mean, we're right there. We have access. I mean, we're economically within 75% of the state of Minnesota, but why, what is the reason that economic growth isn't happening in our region? So we can't, the healthcare we've talked about all day today, so education, we're add a little bit to that at the end. And of course, I'm coming at it from the business point of view. I really want to stress this, and I think I'm probably cheating on somebody else's presentation. Economic activity or production is based on upload. Consumption is based on download. And too often, we say we're satisfying the consumption needs by looking at the download number. true economic side of that is the upload number. It's what can we get up and out? What files can we get to the graphics? What security or VPN? I think we talked about that cellular. I heard cellular is not, what's the word I want? Privacy?
The satellite, yeah.
Right, you can't provide the privacy, only if you do VPN. That works on business at every level. The VPN adds on the requirement for the broadband that needs to function. I can work from home, I can take my emails, but I can't sign on because I can't get the VPN significant connection to be able to do my work. And that's going to become, in this day and age of IT security, almost all those connections are going to hit that and require that the broadband be increased so that we can just securely talk or communicate. So with that, I think that's my part of that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Next slide is going to quantify to some extent some of the things that Doyle has already talked about. This is off of the website on broadband availability, and you can see in practically every case, every speed, every county is worse off, not in just the state, but in the rest of rural Minnesota as well. If you look at that close enough, you'll probably have the same question I did. How do you get a 0.02% access in Isani County? I thought that can't be right. I did the math, and it's 2.79 people. So I checked the website, and if I'm wrong, it's because D's wrong. Next slide, please. And this is the color-coded map. You'll recognize this as border-to-border eligibility. Those are our five counties, and it looks more like one of those election maps of Arizona, all red, very little blue. Next slide. And this is CAF eligibility. And you can see great swaths of all five counties are also eligible for CAF, too. We have several providers. The major providers in our region are CenturyLink and Frontier. Frontier has a hump up at the top of the county. And next slide.
And
Chisago. So while we share a lot of socio-demographics and economics, we also share a lot of challenges with regard to broadband. There is a digital divide. In the communities, in Pine City, you can get fairly decent speed from either Midco or CenturyLink. But if you get outside the town past the reach of DSL, then you're not in great shape. And a lot of the DSL deployment there is on older copper, so it's not always reliable. I'm on DSL, my line was down the whole weekend. I'm not really sure why. We don't know what the deployment schedule is for CAF2 improvements. This is difficult to get information from our providers. And we're of the opinion that CAF2 will still leave us poorly served because of the type of deployment that's going on and the type of technology chosen. We don't have a lot of competitive provider options. We don't have a lot of respective partnership options to do collaborative build out. And we're not real well suited for wireless because of the topography around here. A lot of trees don't mesh well with that. We have a lot of fiber that runs down the right of way in Pine County, for instance, but we don't really have a lot of access to that in a competitive sense. Next slide. We've only had one successful B2B grant in 3 years, covering one half of one township.
I think that's my slide.
It is your slide. It says Nancy right here.
Answer, we could take it, but I wanted to talk about this one. And before we talk about the challenges of the border-to-border, too, first we want to say we really do appreciate having that option out there and having something out there to go to hopefully bring better broadband. So, yes, we've only had one grant in our five-county region. Not that I believe Kennebec submitted and was unsuccessful a few years back. A lot of applications haven't been submitted because it's a difficult area to do this. We were fortunate in Sunrise Township in Chisago County to be able to do half of one of our townships. I was half of it, almost half, 45% came from a grant. And then of the remaining 55%, CenturyLink did 55% of that. And then the township bonded through special service district bonds for the 45% of that 55%. And it was really pushed by the residents. I don't know that the township would have done it on their own, part of the issue. Townships don't do this kind of thing typically, and so it really was an educational process, but because the residents pushed so hard and CenturyLink really was a great partner in this, we were able to get a successful grant in. But even just for Chisago County, that's one half of one township. We have 9.5 other townships to go. I don't know that we can do it this way. Other communities and counties, we find ourselves a little bit envious, I think, when they have a co-op or something to that effect in their area and they can partner with them and get counties and regions completed. Broadband in much more rural areas than we even are. And the low density, the 50%. So in Chisago County and Isanti, for a township, for a rural township, we're not as rural as some of the areas maybe in Pine and Kennebec counties. And so that 50%, or I should say 45%, 55% that Sunrise came up with, in another community might be quite a bit more. I believe it was around $4,000 per household. It might be more like $7,000 per household in much more rural areas. And we want everybody to have the option. We don't want people being left behind. I think that Robert hit on the uncertainty of the partnerships with CAP too. We also have Frontier in our area, and they did show us early on where they were going to put in their CAP two projects, and it didn't fill their whole area, so we knew there were people missing, and we didn't know how to work with them on that. You know, how can we help them make it fiber to the home? We don't want to see the 10-1 in certain areas, and then also people who are completely missed.
If I can add just very quickly, the Kanawha County application to border to border, our most significant weakness was the provider side of that. I mean, we had to go in without, it was a chicken and an egg thing, and we go, if we can get this money and find this thing, can we locate our provider? That model, that economic model to get a provider in is huge. When you have low density and you're trying to take those dollars and seeing what the average cost of the install is based on the revenue stream, the payback on that model has to be something that not the private people are going to accept. So you either have to find funding for a much longer term payout, which is what we went to the county for, to say, would you be willing to use your bonding rate and whatever to provide that payout? But then to the provider, we still have to come back and say, now you have to provide the technology and that stuff and the payback on that. And she hit it right on the head, those areas that are fortunate enough to have a co-op in that area stand a much better chance of getting it done. And if you don't have a co-op in that area to do it, you don't have a provider at this point. So the other part about CAP is, while it will improve, again, the download part, it does not do a significant improvement on the upload, so from an economic, it doesn't meet that, right? But it also makes us, locks us into inferior service for a longer period of time. Because they are capturing that retail dollar, it makes that model that much harder to get to for a much longer period of time. And I really want to say that again. The CAP funding actually locks us into inferior service for a longer period of time. And I think we're going to come up with the statistics to prove that.
I did pass out the Chisago County survey that we did a couple of years ago. I know you know this stuff, we hear it all the time. But we did pass it out because of economic development.
Mm-hmm.
31% of our people in the survey, of our residents, said that they would start a business if they had better broadband. I mean, it's truly, this sold me as an economic developer on why we need to do this. Not having good broadband prevents startups from happening in our community. And that goes along with the statement that Doyle made earlier about the download equals consumption and uploads equal production, and I think he hit on that very well. Also, the retention and attraction of businesses. One of the reasons that we moved forward with the Sunrise application, how it all started, was we had a manufacturing business there that had 45 employees, and their largest cost was broadband. They were data caps, and they were trying to use everything they could to do what they needed to do. They sent blueprints out, to other companies, and they received them, and they weren't able to do that. And of course, they told us they would be moving to Wisconsin. As much as we, would help them try to stay here, that was a true threat to us. And we really wanted to help them, so we were so happy we were able to get this to work with CenturyLink.
And within the last month, the Bram Industrial Park, outside the city of Bram, Diversified, was moving and was expanding and used that lot, and then all of a sudden realized that there was no broadband, fiber broadband to the lot, and started saying, I have to back out. I can't do any function there. Bram City jumped in and said, no, don't worry, we'll get you connected. And what they did is they're going to use TIF financing. So again, there's where the city went in and decided to find and make that bridge. And kept him engaged, and they did their groundbreaking and so forth. So, I mean, a real live example of what it took to, there the city needed to step in and provide that connection as we're going. In Mora, we've created, again, through Blend and Health, the Mora Tech Center, and what that does is it provides a very high-speed connection in the city of Mora, and we use that for telework if they want, if people can't work from home, they can come in and can do that. We're using it as a connection to Pine Tech. We're going to sign a contract with them so that the students can go there and do their lab. Again, all a function of we can do that because we can get the high speed in the city, but we can't get it outside. Okay, so we're answering those things. We're trying to come up with very creative ways to get that done. Okay. The attraction of talented workforce, I'm sure that in the medical presentation today you've heard about attracting the doctors, not only from the professional side, but I think from the quality of life. The Cambridge administrator has said in a quote, when I get the doctors to consider coming to Cambridge, one of the questions he has to answer is where they're going to live and whether or not they're going to have access to broadband. Ironically, today, as I was coming up, I had a presentation with the HRA today, and there was the editor of the Kanawha County Times. And she turns to me and she says, so give me the latest on broadband. Okay? And she goes, at least once a year, my husband and I have a discussion of whether or not we're going to move from our home, which is 4 miles outside the city limits of Mora, because of the broadband connection. And she said, and you can use that as a quote. So here we have the editor of the Times, who can set tone through the paper, saying this is what we need to do, and it's hitting me personally. So she said, use that as a quote.
And I think this group, I'm preaching to the choir. We talk about the need for broadband access in higher ed. College like Pine Tech, where a fair number of students live out in the countryside, outside of town, they've been really inconvenienced because of the speed differential. And over time, I think that Pine, now when I got there, we had a website and it wasn't very good. But we've evolved over time where practically every course has some element that requires distance learning access. And there are some courses, some programs where the entire course or program is available online. But we had to solve that by keeping our library open until 10 o'clock at night so the students could stay on, do their homework, and then go home. Kind of defeated the purpose. Same thing for K-12. A lot of concern for interest in doing flipped classrooms, but the former retired superintendent at Pine City is really discouraged by that because his students who live outside the city limits, outside the quota limits, just didn't have sufficient bandwidth to do what they needed to do. And as has been mentioned already, other more rural regions have doesn't work for us because of our situation. And border to border, as currently structured, is very difficult for us to access because of lack of capacity in terms of tax base and lack of provider partnership. And we wanted to float just a trial balloon in the form of a question for the group to ponder. We don't need an answer to it. It's just something to consider. With state bonding on a regional basis for a region like GPS, with a regional gigabit provider partner be a solution for our region and other poorly served regions? We're not going to try to answer it. We don't expect
you
to.
I'll help you with it.
Okay.
I know the answer to that question. Because I would love for that to be the answer to the question. But I will tell you what the Department of MMB will tell you, because I have gone around and around with them for years on this question. So first of all, let me thank you for your passion and coming here today, because you are passionate people, and that is great. And I think we can address a couple issues. You know that CAF 2 is not our program.
We know that.
And as much as we would have liked to see the speed standards different on CAF 2, the federal government did not make them different. So we are all in the same box on that. So that is what it is. State bonding, there's a old Dorsey and Whitney opinion that was written now probably about 25 years ago, maybe longer. And for my entire time in the state legislature, I tried to fight this opinion, the opinion was that you could never use state bond dollars for technology. And that has been ruled as both hardware and software. Now I get software, I understand that totally. But I do not understand why a governor of this state does not sign a bill that has bond dollars for broadband, because other states have them. And I have tried to convince the previous governor, and tried to convince this governor, that that is the right thing. So join me. Help me try to convince them.
Happy to.
But that's why you fight an uphill battle, because there's an old bond agreement. They are not our bond council anymore for the state of Minnesota, but it still holds weight in the eyes of the law on why that is not the case. So there, that's your answer. I would love for that to be different. I know it very, very well. I wrote a whole paper in graduate school about that issue. So.
Well, and from our common history with Minsky, I was aware of that opinion.
Yeah.
But this is something that perhaps we could, as a region, work with you and we'll talk to our legislators and see if we can get some traction.
It's really a frustrating opinion, because other states have used their bond authority. I mean, it's the reason that we structured the program the way we structured. We had no ability to really do anything else. You know, we created this program before reverse auction. You know, some states have asked, you know, why didn't you do reverse auction for spectrum, blah, blah, blah. Folks, we did this program before that even existed as a possibility. We were ahead of our time. And so, you know, we are now coming into what I would call, you know, you all want to think the governor has 18 months to serve. I believe the governor has 6 months to serve about, which means that the governor has the term of the legislature to really serve and get anything done. And so if we want to get anything done, that's what we get done. So that's the reality of this situation. Or you convince the next governor, whoever that may be, what to do. But that, and we all our terms all expire at the end of this governor's term. So there may or may not be another governor's broadband task force. But we appreciate your passion on this. Many of the things that you have said are things that we've heard. And honestly, most of our work has been rural for the entire existence of both Task Force 1 and Task Force 2. It became very clear to us that connecting Minnesotans meant connecting rural Minnesotans largely. There are some issues that exist for us in urban Minnesota, but largely this has been an issue of access for rural Minnesotans, and very specifically, very rural Minnesotans who do not have great options, usually those get it. We appreciate your passion. We'd love to, you know, work with you to push this issue. I just have never been able to get traction on it.
We can assure you we will continue to push as a region. We're just getting started on this.
I can tell. I don't want to kill your passion.
We've all done it within our community.
I can probably provide you that memo pretty easily.
But one element of our work plan moving forward with our technical assistance project, Landon, is to do some work with our legislators as a region.
Yeah.
Thinking we can have more impact as five counties speaking together.
And I think, Dana, you probably have some information about other states that have used state bond dollars to do these sorts of things.
I know, that's top of mind.
But
yes, New York has invested in more Massachusetts.
But there are a few states that have used bond dollars.
Help me out. What's settlement? What's the difference?
They use their settlement from
financial crisis,
financial crisis stuff to do their.
And the governor just said use it for.
Yeah.
So you have to go through the legislative process.
Now, I just have to interject here because I didn't realize that you had done all that work on that in the past, and that's really good to know, Margaret, and I would like to try to work with you with that. But, you know, when we were trying to do some bonding for broadband as well, and we went to the Attorney General's office, and we actually got a new bond agreement. And I think it's useless for all practical purposes. I don't know why, because I haven't followed up, but let me just, this is not political at all. But the person who went to the Attorney General's office with them to get a new bond opinion was Ryan Winkler, and he is running for Attorney General right now. So when Margaret said influence the people who may be coming in or running for office or make those connections and that type of stuff, that's how you get change made. And so he has a really strong interest in this topic, and he really tried to help me with that at that point. And so.
And I'm sure that they possibly relied on that old bond opinion and however they structured their, what they said.
Well, I've stepped forward it to Dana before, and it has something to do with the type. It's just a portion of it, but really nobody has interest in it. And I think in the final analysis, you can, they just don't want to go down that road, pardon the pun, they'd rather do roads.
So. Okay, well, thank you
thank
all.
You.
Stay in touch here as we go forward.
Appreciate the time and the
We're going to have Fred come up for a couple minutes here. Fred, you stand between us and adjournment, and you know that?
Yeah. Well, who has something hard? Because you may need to throw it at me. You know how I can talk forever. We are having a groundbreaking ceremony the 27th from 11 to 12. You're all welcome to attend. What will be happening at our groundbreaking ceremony will be a little different than normal. So we will be placing the central office. It'll be a big truck will show up, big crane will unload it, set it on the ground, and we'll connect it up to the fiber that's there, which means we literally can turn things on.
Excellent.
We are ready to start plowing fiber. We will probably get a significant portion of it in this year.
Right.
All of the technical stuff aside, although that's where my interests lie, I can tell you some pretty interesting things on the business side. We will be offering service for $49 a month for a 50 meg service.
Wow.
Which is not a good deal, because we will be offering gigabit service both down and up for $99.
Wow.
What we did is we looked at what it took to maintain the system, and we can maintain and upgrade and move whatever we need to do with the system if every customer in our projection took the minimum service level. There is not a significant difference for the bandwidth from cost to go from 50 meg to gigabit for us. I mean, there is a difference, but there's not a significant difference. In all of the discussions I hear on broadband, it strikes me that almost always the discussion gets mired in infrastructure. And there is a cost for infrastructure, obviously. a pretty expensive cost. I mean, I think we're operating on about $2 a foot to plow fiber in, and about $8 a foot to pour it in when you have to shove it underneath stuff. But those costs are temporary. What I mean by that is you have a certain amount of time that those take to get paid back. Your fiber has a lifespan of 25 years. And the elephant in the room kind of is nobody's talking about why does the bandwidth cost so much? Because the cost of delivered bandwidth are the same in Minneapolis or Chicago or Ely. It's all the hops and the pricing that increases in between. And one of the things that we had some very strong discussions about were there was a certain portion of our tribal council that wanted to charge market fair rates. And there was a much larger portion that said, no, we want this to be as affordable as possible. We want to provide gigabit service for what other people are charging for 60 megs. So I'm pretty excited to be able to share that. Those are the draft rates that are out. It's $100 a month.
And so what's your, we're just kind of curious, and it would be interesting if you could send this, what's your predicted take rate? And then we'd love to know maybe in, before we publish the report, what the take rate is.
Okay, actually, there's no reason I can't share that with you. We are operating off of industry standard take rates. That for all of our projections.
Okay.
But we've also done tons of surveying. We've got lots of surveys out. And we're estimating that we're going to probably come in about 25% higher than what the industry said.
So that would be very interesting, because I think that what we heard in Rock County was kind of a similar type of prediction and then take rate. And so what would be fascinating is to hear that from you and a little more detail on the project before we go to publication with the report.
Sure, how soon do you need that? I mean, I can...
We don't have to have that
until late
September, early October.
I'll have to, you know, get the blessing of the tribal
but
I'm sure they'd be willing to share that. They appreciate all the help and the assistance we've got.
That would be great, and we'd love to, you know, and we'd love to hear that.
Yeah, it will give some real, I think, eye-opening data on what people really do and really think when they can actually afford the service. You know, I failed to mention that we also will have a lifeline level service for those who qualify that would cost them nothing.
Wow, very good.
Well, after the lifeline discount, right?
I'm way oversimplifying.
You'll get your $34.25.
Yep.
Yeah, so,
we priced it in such a fashion that if they qualify for all the
incentives,
it's zero.
Okay, got it. Totally. Okay, cool. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for coming up on short notice.
Oh, no problem.
A bit.
I'm always available.
Yes, and how's the restoring the pinball machines going?
We've done. Moved on to the next project.
What's the next project?
We are currently working on a system to completely automate our makerspace. We have two locations now, another building, and we're doing video between the two and complete automation. We already built the automated entry control, temperature control, and everything else, and now we want automated communication between the two. All centered around the Amazon Echo.
All right.
Just a bunch of geeky stuff.
All right, thank you. Well, I think with that, thank you, Fred. Thanks for coming up. We're not going to belabor this a lot because I know we are now over time. We're going to meet in August. We're going to meet in St. Paul. Stay tuned for the location. We have to negotiate. We did reserve the State Senate building, but apparently they're telling us we can't eat in there anymore. So we're going to see if we can negotiate that. If we can't negotiate that, we may be going back to Bede. So that's where we're at. And 16th of August. So we'll probably be doing a little